God's servants who went before, and this evening we have with us Pastor Annette Alexia Shields. Her husband and her two beautiful daughters are here, along with members of our congregation. We welcome you and we thank you for coming. Amen. Amen. It is such a blessing to see these two young daughters. Whenever there is an event at Soul Harvest, to see how they serve with such excellence and humility. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. It's a pleasure to see how they go about it, and they do not sit until everyone is served. You know, sometimes children would want to sit and eat. These two girls will not sit until everyone has their plate in front of them. I've seen it. I've seen it with them. This, the heart of a servant is within them. Amen. And praise God. Keep doing what you are doing for the Lord. God bless, God bless. God bless, God bless. Pastor Anna Shields was born in Ontario, Canada, to the late Reverend Theland A. Johnson and Reverend Ruby Johnson, the co-founders and second pastor of Soul Harvest Evangelistic Center. She grew up in the church along with one brother and sister and has served in various capacities since childhood. She made a decision to publicly follow the Lord in water baptism at age 13 and was filled with the Holy Ghost at age 16. A solid Christian foundation has taught Pastor Shields the value of faithfully serving in the ministry. She has served as an usher, a Sunday school teacher, a youth leader, choir director, youth president, as well as in various auxiliaries. Her first love has always been singing, and she has ministered in song for many years. Her desire has never been to become famous, but just to be a blessing to the body of Christ. Pastor Shields received her Bachelor's of Science degree in nursing, graduating cum laude from the City College of New York. She's a registered nurse currently working in the Surgical Intensive Care Unit at Mount Sinai Beth Israel Medical Center. She's a dedicated and compassionate nurse who takes every opportunity to be a blessing to patients and co-workers alike. Pastor Shields is married to evangelist Michael Shields, who is also a collaborator together in the ministry. They have been married for 25 years and have been blessed with three beautiful daughters. This woman of God continues to be a blessing, whether it's singing, teaching, preaching the word of God, of serving others. Since the passing of her mother and pastor, the late Reverend Ruby Johnson, Pastor Shields has taken on the mantle to keep the flames burning at Soul Harvest Evangelistic Center. On April 17, 2016, Pastor Shields was ordained and officially installed as the third pastor in the history of Soul Harvest Evangelistic Center. Congregation, please stand. With us is a great woman of God and a solid foundation, solid Christian foundation. I ask that you honor the woman of God as you put your hands together and receive Pastor Anna Shields.
Thank you. Hallelujah. May be seated. It's an honor to be here tonight, and I greet you in the precious name of Jesus. I greet your pastor, Dr. Yvette Williams, in the name of Jesus, and it's good to be fellowshipping with you all here again. Amen. Reverend Baxter, God bless you. And Reverend Dr. Roper, amen. I greet you in the precious name of Jesus. I just thank God for bringing us into this place tonight to worship him. Me came Evangelist Shields, my right hand and my left hand. Amen. Put your hands together. My two daughters, Yami and Sarah. Deacon Asparagus is here, Mother Hines is here, Sister Sunshine is here. They are here, I'm going to ask you to come join them right here so you can be close to my heart. Praise God. You need some people that are close to your heart, you know? The way that Jesus had three disciples that were close to his heart, but yet when it came time for prayer, we asked him to come with him. And where were they? They were sleeping. So it's never really in the crowd, but it's in the faithful few. Amen. And tonight we are split up. And there is an appreciation for Dr. Belbry Cox. And I spoke with her, so they went over there earlier to just show their face and come over here, and the rest went to Queens. And you know how it is in church work. What encouraged you? I did not come with excellency of speech, and I didn't come with eloquent words. I just came to give you a simple word. Hallelujah. And to confirm the word that's already been delivered over these past days. Hallelujah. I said I came to deliver a simple word, and the word will be confirmed that has been delivered over these past few days. Amen. And so we just want to encourage you in the theme, amen, of your prayer fest, teach us to pray. Let's go to the word. Amen. Luke chapter 11 from verse 1 to 4. And would you mind just standing as we read? We're going to read together 4 verses. Amen? You ready? Amen. And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And he said unto them, when ye pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Father, your word is already blessed, and we thank you right now. We ask, God, that as we come to hear from you, that you speak through your vessel. Amen. Hallelujah. Speak to your people the words, the necessary words that they need to hear. Your word will not return unto you empty. It must return, hallelujah, and it must accomplish the task that it set out to accomplish. Hallelujah. It must take root somewhere, in someone. It must fall on good ground. I pray, God, that you would touch your people right now. Let your word fall on good ground like seeds that fall on good ground. Let it germinate and let it grow. Hallelujah. We thank you, God, that you will deliver, you will heal, you will touch in the name of Jesus through your word and through the prayer of faith in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Teach us to pray. It's a wonderful thing. And you know what? Throughout the scriptures, there are various patterns of prayer that teach us how to pray in order to get specific results. So we've seen this from time past in the Old Testament, how many people got a prayer through. Amen. From Abraham to Joseph to Jacob, hallelujah, to Isaac, to Rebecca, to Esther, amen, to Jabez, to Daniel. So they have had specific prayers that they used to get God's ear and get his attention. Hallelujah. So this specific chapter where Jesus is praying and his disciples see him praying, one of the disciples says they, I guess, waited till he was finished to ask him, Lord, teach us to pray. No doubt they had seen him pray before. No doubt they had looked at his life, his ministry. And if you look at his life and his ministry, you notice that one thing is very consistent. He was always praying. Amen? He was always praying. There's no time that you're really going to find him not praying. Prayed at his own baptism when he came out of the water. He went into the mountains to pray. Sometimes he went alone. Sometimes he went all night. He skipped meals. He skipped food to pray. He prayed before he performed miracles. He prayed before any major event in his ministry. He prayed before he ate food. He prayed when he was with the publicans and the sinners. Amen? He prayed for children. He put his hands upon them and he blessed them. He was always praying. And he prayed before he did any great work. He was continuously praying. And even on the cross, before he went to the cross and he knew what was about to come, he chose three of those disciples and he said, come with me. Will you watch with me? Just for 1 hour. And pray. They didn't really go with him all the way. But he still prayed. Until his drops became, until his sweat became drops of blood. And when he was on the cross, he prayed again. Hallelujah. So he was praying without ceasing. So if there's a life that has prayed without ceasing, it's Jesus. Hallelujah. He's been continuous in prayer, effective in prayer, effectual in prayer. And I love the fact that the disciple that came to him didn't say, teach me how to preach a sermon. Because they had been with Jesus. And yet, words that no man could even understand how he came up with those words. Their eyes were fixed upon him when he began to speak and when he began to read the scripture. But they didn't ask him, teach me how to preach a sermon. They didn't say, teach me how to read the scriptures and get everyone's attention. They didn't say, teach me how to perform a miracle. Because we are focused on the wrong thing today. We want to go to school to be a prophet. We want to go to school to be an evangelist and do this. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying these things are wrong. But when it comes to prayer, where are you? You got to have a life of prayer before you can be effective in any other area Can I say that again? I said you've got to have a life of prayer before you can be effective in any area of ministry. So sometimes we're focused on the wrong thing. Jesus spoke about being seen and wanting to be seen. That's not the purpose of prayer. And neither it is the purpose of any other ministry in the body. Not to be seen, but to give glory to God. And so I see and I gather that when Jesus prayed everywhere he went and every chance that he got, he was able to be effective anywhere. Walking by people, they get healed. When you begin to pray consistently, you don't have to call people out, touch them, and make them fall. You can just walk by them. All you got to do is pray. Be consistent in prayer. When you minister to someone, you just minister by walking next to them. You just begin to open your mouth and have an ordinary conversation. And your ordinary conversation turns into a message. Hallelujah. So the disciples were right when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. Not to say prayers, but to pray. To live a life of prayer. To live a life of consistent prayer. To live a life of effectual prayer. To live a life that is effective in any other area. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Call a prayer meeting. And you see how many people turn up. The story is told of a man who went into a church. The church is a big church in England. And the church was beautiful. The edifice was beautiful. And down in the basement, he was showing his sanctuary to someone. Took them down into the basement, and when he took them down into the basement, there were people praying. And the person who he was showing the edifice to was kind of impressed. But when the pastor opened his mouth, he said, I hired these people to pray. Because there's no one in the church to come out and pray willingly. And in order for the church to move on, I have to hire these people to pray. Don't let it get like that. Be the one that will be consistent in prayer. Be the one that will pray without ceasing. Be the one that will seek after God with all your heart. And not just how to say a prayer, but they wanted to know how to live a life of prayer. They wanted to know how prayer could become a part of them. Amen. They wanted to know how prayer would make them different, how it would transition them. They wanted to know how prayer would impact their life on a daily basis so they could impact lives the way that Jesus impacted every life that he came in contact with. Is that what we want? Is that what we want? Hallelujah. And so Jesus said, you want to know how to pray? Let me tell you. This is how you pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, this is how you pray. Our Father in heaven. The same scripture is taken from Matthew chapter 6, but spoken in a little different way. But he said, our Father in heaven. We've got to establish a relationship with the Father. We've got to show him who he is. We've got to acknowledge who he is. Why? Because God is relational. Amen? And we just can't just look at him as a separate entity without relation. Without relationship. Evangelist Shields is relation to me is that he's my spouse. My children, their relationship to me is that they're my children. Some of you in the audience have a relationship with siblings. Spouses. There's a relationship. between the pastor and you, the congregants.
Yes.
So there's always building on a relationship. And that's who God is. He's relational. That's how he gets along with us. Amen?
Yes.
The model prayer shows that we must come to God as our Father in heaven and recognize who he is. But how do we get to establish this relation with the Father? We've got to come to him through Jesus.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. We've got to come to him through Jesus. Yeah. John 14, 6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Yeah.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
Yeah.
And when you come to the Father through Jesus Christ, the relationship is established. So when you come to him in prayer, you're going to acknowledge him and you're going to verify that relationship.
Oh.
I always tell the church, I said, the analogy that I give is a bank-client relationship.
Yeah.
In order for you to go into a bank and withdraw money, you've got to establish a bank-client relationship.
Right.
If you walk into that bank and you try to get money, and you don't have a bank-client relationship, you're coming out in handcuffs.
Yeah.
Am I right about it?
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
When you establish that bank-client relationship, you can go into that bank at any time, and you can withdraw money. You can deposit money. You can notarize documents. You can take out a loan if they'll give it to you. You can do a lot of things.
Amen.
But there's always a verification process.
Yeah.
They ask you for ID.
Yeah.
Whether it's your bank card or your driver's license.
Whoa.
You have to establish and verify the relationship before you can do anything else.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
I was in our bank for church, it's the M&T Bank, and there was a man in front of me. He came in, he gave his driver's license, and the teller couldn't find it in the system. She said, let me get your bank card. When he took out the bank card and handed it to her, it was a TD Bank card. So M&T is green, TD Bank is green, they almost look similar. He was in the wrong bank trying to get money. If she didn't ask for verification, he couldn't get the money. You understand what I'm saying? So we've got to verify the relationship with the Lord. Approach him as our Father in heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your relationship is established, and Jesus called God his Father so many times. Even he did it. Every time that he prayed, he spoke to his Father.
Yeah.
So how much more us? Right. And so that's why he said to them, our Father in heaven. Relationship is verified.
Right.
Hallowed be thy name. Hallelujah. It means that his name is set apart. It's to say that there's no one else like God. He's completely unique.
Yes.
And so when you come before him, we've got to reverence him and give him glory.
Yes.
We glorify his name and we give him the praise that he deserves.
Yes.
The relationship is verified.
Yes.
Our Father who art in heaven.
Yes.
Hallowed be thy name.
Yes.
His name is glorified.
Yes.
Hallelujah. You've got to give him glory. Sometimes we come to him depressed, broken, sad, oppressed, discouraged, but that doesn't change who God is. You still gotta give him glory. You gotta glorify his name. Why? Because he deserves it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And so, regardless of the circumstances, we've got to lift the Lord high above our situation. Before you request anything, lift him high.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That even when I'm going through my difficulty, my situation, my pain, my discouragement, my problems, when I start to glorify sad. But I may have just begun to glorify his name for 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And 2 minutes turns into 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And 5 minutes turns into 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And 10 minutes turn into 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And I'm still glorifying God.
Yeah.
And I'm forgetting about what I even came to God for.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I said I'm here. And now his will must become priority.